So today we are covering text number 45 to 49 from the 11th chapter of the Gita. And the title for today's discussion is Seeing God Face to Face. By the way, how many of us have seen God? Others yet to see. Hoping to see. Okay. Prabhupada was asked, have you seen God? And depending on the audience, whether they were devotees or they were completely raw, he at different times gave different answer. Not that because he hasn't seen God, but depending on the audience, he gave different answer. I'll share that as we move forward in this discussion today. So, based on the teachings of Srila Prabhupada, his wonderful insights in the purports, let's chant this verse together.
Adrishta purvam shito asmi drishtva bhayena cha pravittham manome tadeva me darshaya devarupam prasida devesha jagannivasa.
Translation. After seeing this universal form, which I have never seen before, I am gladdened, but at the same time my mind is disturbed with fear. Therefore, please bestow your grace upon me and reveal again your form as the personality of Godhead, O Lord of Lords, O abode of the universe. These are the words spoken by Arjuna to Krishna after having seen the universal form. So here he said, I am gladdened. Can anyone help me with an answer? Why Arjuna is glad that he saw the universal form? Why is he glad? And apparently there's a contradiction. Simultaneously saying, I am fearful. On one side he's saying, I am glad. The other side, he's also mentioning that he is fearful. So he's glad that the Lord is so opulent. All the energies, all the potencies, all the devas are within him. He is the source of everything. So that made him glad that Krishna is not an ordinary person. That person who is with him, who is his companion, who is his sarathi in the battle, accompanying him, with him, is not an ordinary personality. It's the Supreme Lord himself who is all powerful. So that is the source of his happiness. And why is he fearful? He is fearful because till now he never had the understanding that Krishna, whom he was treating like a friend, like an ordinary driver, was not an ordinary personality. And in the previous verse we discussed, he said, unknowingly, unintentionally, I might have committed many, many offenses by calling him by casual names. Sometimes, you know, when we don't realize somebody's greatness, maybe we may go to an office and we don't know who the boss is, and we may find somebody walking around and may not respect him, but later on when we recognize that he is the boss, maybe we have mixed feelings, some element of I shouldn't have acted like this. So same is the case with Arjuna here. Now the universal form which Arjuna saw, it's not eternal form of the Lord. It is material form and it is temporary. It was shown to Krishna, so Arjuna, and it was wound up. Now Arjuna is requesting Krishna, yes, I have seen your universal form. Now I am keen on seeing your original form, the spiritual form, the four-handed form. The next verse is about Arjuna requesting for that. So the original form of the Lord, this brings us to the point that many people believe that Lord has no form. God is some kind of a power, some kind of energy. From him everything has come. But the understanding we get from our scriptures that God, no doubt, has innumerable energies, but behind that energy is the energetic. There is universal intelligence which is running the whole cosmos. But behind that intelligence is the intelligent creator. Whose intelligence? Whose energy? From where it is emanating? So just like you and me are a person, God also is a person. But he is not an ordinary person. Generally, why do we feel difficult to accept God as a person? Because in our experience, we have come across people, individuals, beings who are limited in time and space. Suppose today you are here in the class, I can very confidently say that you are in Mumbai. If somebody comes and says, no, so and so is out of station. No, I saw him in the class. Because it is very, very obvious that if you are here in the class, you are not out of station. On the other side, we know that Lord is omnipresent. He is present everywhere. So if we give a form to the Lord has a form, he is a person, then that quality of the Lord, that he is omnipresent, he is present everywhere, he is present in each and every atom, he is present in everything, becomes difficult to comprehend. So to safely reconcile with this understanding, people conclude that God is not a person. It's an energy. It's in power. Another thing why we come to the conclusion that God is not a person, because whenever we see a person, we know that person has a body which grows, stays for some time, reproduces, dwindles, decays, and finally dies. It goes through transformation. And we know that Lord is not go through these transformation. He is transcendental. He is beyond these six transformations. Hence, we conclude that since our body goes through transformation, we go through diseases, our body becomes old, we die, but God doesn't do that. He doesn't die, he doesn't become old, he doesn't become diseased. So it is safe to conclude that he doesn't have a form. But our scriptures point out that the Lord has a form. But his form is Sat Chit Ananda Vigraha. It is not an ordinary form. It's not a material form. It's a spiritual form. It's a transcendental form. And what is the quality or nature of that form? It is Sat. It is eternal. Chit, full of knowledge. And Ananda, full of bliss. That's why it is important that when we come to understanding of spiritual subject matter, it is difficult to come to right conclusion sheer by logic and rational thinking. Is that clear to everyone? What I mentioned right now, logically it appears right. He is omnipresent, therefore he doesn't have a form. That's a logical conclusion. But we cannot comprehend the Lord or come to understand about the Lord merely by our logical conclusion or analytical skills. We have to understand about the Lord from Lord himself and his pure devotees. So here Arjuna is saying, please show me that form, the 400 form. The Lord in innumerable spiritual planets, which are also called Vaikuntha Lokas, he has spiritual form, transcendental form with Shankha, Chakra, help me with the other two, Gada and Padma. O universal Lord, I wish to see you in your four-armed form with helmeted head and with club, wheel, conch and lotus flower in your hands. I long to see you in that form. Now, many times when we have some picture of the Lord. So sometimes people say, is it some kind of imagination somebody has painted a picture? Are these imaginary forms? How does the Lord actually look like? So in the scriptures, there are vivid descriptions about the form of the Lord. Like here you sit with helmet, head with club, wheel, conch and lotus flower in your hands. So we get some elements of what the form has. It has hands, what is in the hands, what is on the head. So like that, there are vivid descriptions about the Lord in the spiritual world, and basis which acharyas have, you know, written commentaries, given description about the Lord, glorified the Lord. King Kulasekhar Alwar, he has Mukunda Mala Stotra, he is describing the glories of the Lord. How does he look like? How his hairs are? How his facial expressions are? How his eyes are? And that's how we understand about the Lord. Now here we have the Lord replying. The blessed Lord said, my dear Arjuna, happily do I show you this universal form within this material world by my internal potency. No one before you has ever seen this unlimited and glaringly effulgent form. So Arjuna wanted to see. Krishna gave him that divine vision, and before that no one had seen that universal form. As I said, it's not an eternal form. No one had seen this universal form of Lord before Arjuna. Now, just like Arjuna was blessed with the divine vision, even when we are blessed with the divine vision by the Lord revealed himself to us. That is the process of seeing God. Prabhupada in one place mentions, when Prabhupada was asked, have you seen God? He says, do not be eager to see God. Act in a way God sees you. In other words, Lord has given innumerable instructions for us. What will please him? And if we follow that instructions, the Lord will be pleased with us. He will bestow his mercy. And then we can experience the love, the reciprocation of the Lord. Otherwise, in one sense, we are disqualified. In the battlefield, Arjuna was also there, Duryodhana also was there. Arjuna recognized Krishna as the Supreme Personality of God that Duryodhana could not recognize. O best of Kuru warriors, no one before you has ever seen this universal form of mine, but neither by studying the Vedas, nor by performing sacrifices, nor by charities or similar activities can this form be seen. This is very important. By being a pandit, by being a very learned scholar, by mugging up the entire Gita or the Vedas or all the shlokas, you cannot comprehend the Lord. By doing elaborate sacrifices, you cannot comprehend the Lord. By doing charities or similar activities, this form cannot be seen. Only you have seen this. Can anyone help me, having understood this much, what is the qualification to see the form? Divine vision. Now, one cannot have the divine vision without becoming divine. Right now, although we have a relationship with the Lord, Mamaiv Amsho Jiva Loke, we have a very tangible, concrete relationship with the Lord. It is not just a concept. Just like Prime Minister Narendra Modi is Prime Minister of the country, that understanding is not just a concept, it's a tangible reality. So and so is my father. How confidently I see, if I have to fill a form, father name, mother name, I very confidently fill it up. It's not a belief. It's not a faith. So likewise, eternally that Atma, Mamaiv Amshaju, we have a relationship with the Lord, but that relationship is now forgotten. Why it is forgotten? Why it is forgotten? Just like the sunshine is there, but sometimes we say, it's very cloudy, there is no sun today. Right? The clouds may be just half a kilometer, but then they have no power to cover the sun. The sun is 14,000 times bigger than Earth, but we say today there is no sun because it's very cloudy. So when the clouds of Maya covers our consciousness, the Lord becomes invisible. Just like sun is there, clouds cannot cover the sun. But when there is cloud, the sun is not visible. There are countries where people are not blessed with sunlight. It's not that sun is not there. So when this cloud of Maya covering our consciousness, covering our intellect, then we are not able to perceive the Lord. We are not able to see the Lord. We are not able to experience the reciprocation of the Lord. So human form of life is a wonderful opportunity to remove that covering. So one of the important purpose, in fact, the only purpose of human form of life is self-realization or God-realization. Self-realization and God-realization are synonym. Can anyone tell me why? Why are they synonym? Many times we have heard this word self-realization. In fact, we have a book, Science of Self-Realization. Goal of human life is self-realization. And we also have word God-realization. These words are synonyms. Why? Self-realization is not only the understanding that I am the Atma. Some people reach to that point, Aham Brahmasmi. That is definitely a step towards the highest understanding. I am not the body, I am Atma. Why that self-realization is also God-realization? Because real self-realization involves understanding who that Atma is. And what is that Atma? Is Amsha of Lord. So when you realize Atma in its pure form, you will also realize that Sambandha. Sambandha means the relationship with the Supreme Lord. Who's Amsha? Whose part? Where has it originated from? So right understanding of the self or self-realization includes or is also part of God-realization. So one cannot have divine vision unless a person becomes divine. There's a very nice verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam which says, Labdhva sudurlabham idam bahu sambhavante. After many, many births, this Atma has got this human birth. Manushya Janma, and this Manushya Janma is Durlabham. Durlabham means Durlabh. Durlabh means Sulabh and Durlabh. Durlabh means it's very difficult. Turnam Yateta, Turnam Yateta Napatet Anumrityu Yavan. We have to very quickly, there is a sense of urgency. Yateta means we have to strive for, aspire for. Shudhyet means for purification. Brahma Saukhyam to Anantam. Why purification? When we get purified internally and externally, right now we have become dirty. Our consciousness has become polluted. Polluted of what? Base qualities, lust, greed, envy. Just like a drop of water, it's pure. When it falls on the ground, it becomes muddy. So this Amsha, in its pure form, is devoid of all these base qualities. It's pure. It's divine. But when it comes in contact with this material nature, gets overpowered by Maya or illusion, all these divine qualities gets lost. So many times we strive for developing qualities, like some of us may be very angry, short-tempered. Or some of us may find that, you know, we are very impatient. Or some of us may find that, you know, we are not able to control our appetite. We eat a lot of things. We're not able to restrain or restrict ourselves. These all are symptoms of a bigger disease. Just like when a person may have fever, yes, you can obviously take a paracetamol and the fever comes down, but the fever is symptomatically addressed by taking a paracetamol, but the real cause why the fever has come is not addressed. Just a few days back, one of the devotees, you know, had high temperature, 2 days the fever. So the doctor told, 2 days you take this tablet, and if it does not come down, we'll do a blood test to check whether it's dengue or some other. So 2 days it was symptomatically treated, thinking that it could be because of various other reasons. The fever comes, could be viral, could be something. And if it does not come, after 2 days, we will do a blood test. So that soul, which is Amsha of the Lord, in its pure form is Sat Chit Ananda. And when it contacts this material nature, it becomes polluted. So the Bhagavatam is saying we have to quickly endeavor for Shuddhyet. Shuddhyet means for purification. And what happens when we get purified? Shuddhyet Brahma Saukhyam Tu Anantam. Then we will experience Brahma Saukhyam. Brahma Saukhyam means the real happiness which we all are actually wanting to experience. How many of us want to be happy? We all are trying different ways and means to be happy. Am I right? Yes or no? Different things we are trying. We also become happy at times, but that happiness does not last. It's not lasting happiness. It's not real happiness. Many times that so-called happiness is followed by a misery. In fact, Krishna says, what is illusion? Yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukha yona hi evate. That very bhoga, that very enjoyment which one seeks by senses coming in contact with the sense objects, yehi samsparsha. Sparsha means touch. Senses coming in contact with the sense objects, dukha yona hi evate. That is the breeding ground or the source of misery. God does not want us to be miserable. Many of the miseries which we have attracted in our lives is because of we having acted in ignorance wrongly. And we have missed things. Why this school is there? Why these colleges are there? Why so much of money is spent on education? Because people know ignorance means a person will not act wisely. Why awareness is about traffic laws? Why this concept of driving license? You should know all these laws before you get a license to drive. Because if a person does not know these rules, he'll meet with accidents. So, now it is also mentioned, what are the various aspects of godliness or becoming divine? How many of us have heard this statement, cleanliness is next to godliness? Now, cleanliness is, one is external and one is internal. External cleanliness is definitely being very careful of our daily hygiene, taking bath, being clean clothes, things like that. Internal cleanliness is cleansing our consciousness. So the sadhana bhakti which our acharyas have recommended is to make us pure, clean and divine internally and externally. I was speaking to someone yesterday. He was talking about his children. He says, they're very unclean. I said, why? He says they eat in the bed, they expect the food to be served in the bed, and they don't take bath. I said, what? He says, yes, every day they don't take bath. I said, is it true? He says, yes. So, when we become unclean, when we are dirty, just like you see sometimes laborers, 2 days, 3 days, they don't take bath, they're comfortable with it. They get conditioned. That impure state one becomes in condition to. Prabhupada says, Brahmanas, they take bath minimum 3 times. Because we perspire. No, not everyone. I'm not recommending you all start taking bath 3 days. There will be water shortage in Mumbai. But nevertheless, cleanliness is important, external. So likewise, internal cleanliness. Once Srila Prabhupada, he visited a temple, and after the Darshanarti, Govindam Adi Purusham, that song and all that, the whole morning thing happened. And then Prabhupada was walking around in the temple, and he happened to visit the Pujari room. The room next to the altar where all the aarti plates, after the aarti is done, that's taken and it's washed. So aarti had got over, you know, the morning program had got over, and in that Pujari room, all the aarti plates were lying completely unclean. They had not washed. So Prabhupada went in, and he was apparently disturbed. He was not very happy seeing that this aarti plates are not washed. Generally in a temple, if you visit any of our temples, you will find it is very, very clean. The standards are very high. If you have to enter the altar, you have to change your dress. If you go to a bathroom, to a loo, you have to change the dress, and after you come back, you have to take a bath before you enter the altar. The very high standards, and there is a reason why. It is not just for tormenting the devotees. There's a reason, because you're dealing with the Lord who is all pure, and to also instill in something false, you know, the way the plates are kept, everything is meticulously clean. We have a concept called maha cleaning. Have you heard of this word, maha cleaning? So weekly, twice, all of us in the temple, all of us irrespective of cadre, clean the temple. That's called maha cleaning. That maha cleaning is other than the regular cleaning which happens every day. So Prabhupada went and he saw the aarti plates were unclean, and you know, it was not washed. So then he was little not very happy. And then, you know, he started cleaning himself. So immediately the words that Prabhupada is cleaning, somebody saw, and you know, and the devotees are, no, Prabhupada, please don't do it, devotees will do it. So Prabhupada looked at them and said, am I not a devotee? Should I not clean? So an acharya is a person who walks the talks. He leads by example, shows by example. So Prabhupada himself was very clean, and he also demanded that cleanliness from his disciples. So divine means to become pure devotee of the Lord. Now, how do we become pure devotee of the Lord? When we are externally pure, for sure, and we are internally pure. Our consciousness is pure. It is not possible to decry Krishna and at the same time have the divine vision. In the heart we have jealousy, we have resentment, we have hatred, we have envy, we have lust. We cannot comprehend the Lord. We are disqualified to have a relationship with the Lord. One can perform bodily penances, give charity, study the Vedas, etc. But unless he is a pure devotee, unless he becomes a devotee. Now, pure devotee also, yes, long way to go, but it's not a 0-1 logic, binary logic. As we become more and more pure, the more and more we are able to relate with the Lord, appreciate the Lord. Now, all what we are doing, including the discussion what we have, Gita Live sessions, the chanting we have, it's for our purification. All of you agree with this statement? How does hearing the message of the Lord purify us? How does satsang purify us? Huh? How does it purify us? Mukunda? How does we all come, we hear, we chant, we do kirtans, we do arati? How does it purify? Why does it purify? What is the logic? There's a verse in the Bhagavatam, Shrunvata Sukatha Krishna. Shrunvata, Shrun means hearing. Shrunvata Sukatha Krishna, Punya Shravana Kirtana, which is very, very auspicious. Krishna, His holy names, His paraphernalia, all this is very, very potent, very, very auspicious. Shunvata Swakatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirtana. Punya Shravana, this is very, very potent, very, very powerful, very, very auspicious. We all want to do auspicious things. We want to usher auspiciousness in our house, auspiciousness in our lives. Acharyas have chanted the names of the Lord. Prabhupada, when he went to London, there was a place which was being sold. It was sold at a very dirt cheap price because that house apparently was ghostly haunted. Somebody had died and nobody wanted to purchase that house, and you know, it was being sold as a desperate sale, and somebody was selling it at a very... So Prabhupada took that house, the devotees went inside the house, did nice kirtan and stayed in that house. Because when we chant the names of the Lord, all the inauspiciousness... These days, very people are very cautious of vastu and, you know, all this. What are the shung shai? What is that? All those things. No doubt, as far as possible, we can take care, but there are too many parameters to handle in this world. Vastu-wise, you might be compliant. Other parameter-wise, you may not be compliant. As far as possible, we take care, but the Brahmastra is chant the names of the Lord. It ushers in all auspiciousness. In your life, where you are staying, and everywhere. So all what we do is basically Shrunvata Swakatha Krishna Punya Shravana Kirta Hridantastuya Bhadrani, all the dirty things which are there in our heart. Anta means inside. Abhadra means dirty, impure. Vidunoti means it destroys. Just like mountains are broken into pieces by a thunderbolt. Vidunoti surutsatam, by hearing those auspicious messages about the Lord, by chanting the glories of the Lord, which is full of auspiciousness, full of potency, all the impurities, all the dirty things which are there covering our consciousness in our heart, vidunoti surutsatam, and one becomes purified. So, when I first started going to the ISKCON temple, that was way back in 1989. So first I met the devotees in the temple. I was very impressed because very educated, you know, good families. The chairman whom we were interacting with those days, he was from IIT Mumbai alumni, and our vice president, he was from Indian Institute of Science, very premier institute in Bangalore. So I was talking to them, and you know, they are science graduates. I could relate with them. I could talk to them. Sometimes when we deal with sadhus, you know, they are a different species. Yes or no? If you go to Kumbh Mela, they are, you know, with ashes on their body, not having clothes. You can't relate with them. Yes or no? Bole nahi bole, kya hai ka ye? Now here I saw, you know, well-meaning individuals, educated, also talking about God. So that was my initial, you know, relationship with them. So I really appreciated them for their intelligence, for the philosophy what they were sharing, the knowledge about God. We should have some discussion. I would have some doubts, I will ask. And very satisfying answer I used to get. So I appreciated that. And then invariably when I used to go to the temple, I used to have prasadam. That was also, I was very fond of prasadam. And I used to appreciate prasadam a lot. But one thing was a big question mark in my mind. The philosophy was good. The devotees were good. You know, what they were sharing, the message was good. But one thing which was very, very difficult for me to digest. Can anyone guess what is that? Difficult. It took a lot of time. Huh? It was, you know, people, devotees dancing, jumping and dancing, you know, wildly in kirtans. First time when I saw the devotees, I was taken aback. Ye kya ho raha hai? Is this also bhakti? Jumping, you know, hitting the drums and jumping. Because, you know, typically when you see some spiritualist in a church, you know, walking slowly, grave. So what kind of devotion is this? It's a big question mark. And especially if you go in a kirtan, in the temple, when the kirtan is on, and if you're standing like this, they'll pull you in. So whenever kirtan time was then, I used to just walk out of the temple. And prasadam time, I would enter back. So this went on for many days. Because kirtan means, you know, jumping like this and everything was fine. But why they are jumping was a very big question mark for me. And why like this? How many of us have seen ISKCON? Could kirtan, you know, people jumping and dancing? Anyone? Most of you have seen, yeah. So, I was very reluctant. So one day, so I used to like hearing Bhagavad Gita class, would like talking to the devotees, would like reading Prabhupada books, and would also obviously like prasadam, but the jumping and dancing part was alien to me. So one day I was hearing in a class, the speaker told, you know, two kinds of people cannot dance. So, you know, my eyes, ears, you know, kya bol raha, mere baare mein bol raha hai. There are two kinds of people cannot dance. Today we'll dance, let us see who can't dance. Two kinds of people cannot dance. So I said, you know, I was curious to know, what are these two kinds of people? He says, one, those who are envious of God, those who are not in God's party. Again, it was difficult. How can he say that I am envious of God and therefore I am not dancing? How can I be? In other words, why will I come to the temple? So then I thought maybe it is just one way of enthusing me to dance. It appeared to me that that whole conversation was directed keeping me in mind. One thing is who is envious of the Lord, a person who is not part of God's party. And then I raised my hand. I said, how do you say that? God's party and not, no, not part of, envious of God. So he said, just like when these elections happen, you know, you have political rallies. You will have a political rally, you know, congressmen, Rajiv Gandhi, Jindabad, Rajiv Gandhi, Jindabad. You know, BJP people, will they say Rajiv Gandhi, Jindabad? They'll feel, why they are chanting Rajiv Gandhi? Yes or no? When Modi will come, they say Modi. You cannot chant the names of person who is of the opposing party. Yes or no? Agreed what I'm saying? If says Jai Shri Ram, Jai Shri Ram, who will say? Hanuman will say Jai Shri Ram. What will Ravan say? Will say Jai Shri Ram? He will not say. He cannot say. Because he wants Sita. He doesn't want Ram. So then he said, just like when it is name of Rama, Hanuman will chant, Jai Shri Ram. Ravana will not chant. Ravana is in the opposing party. When the battle happened, Hanuman was on the side of Ram. Ravana was in the opposing party. So if you are part of the opposing party, you will not chant the names of Lord. Does it make sense? Yes? Second, he says, those who are loaded with a lot of sins, burdened with sins, the sins are so overwhelming. The burden of sin is, imagine if you have, figuratively, if you're holding 50 kgs of, you know, bag in your left hand, right hand, and I ask you to jump. Can you jump? 50 kgs on the left hand, 50 kgs on the right hand, jump. You can't jump because there's a load. So if we are loaded with a lot of sinful reactions, we are very sinful, we are very impious, we are not pure, impurities are weighing on us, we will not be able to jump. So after having heard that, you know, I felt internally offended. Thoda maja nahi hai. How can he say that I am impure, I am, you know, itna chanting kar raha hu main, aata hu yahan pe. So one day, you know, I went, when the kirtan was going on, and, you know, by the side of the wall, I was also shy, you know, sabke saamne mein naachna kya. You know, it was not a, what will people think, you're shy. So I went, the kirtan was going on, and by the side of the wall, and slowly I raised my hands, left side and right side. Almost till this point I raised the hand. I said, now, see, at least I'm able to raise the hands. That means some element of piety is there. Thoda sin kam hai. And then the beats of the kirtan was so, you know, inclusive that I saw that, you know, slowly the kirtan is going on, the legs started moving. And I was very conscious, anybody is not looking at me, bolega, you know, he started dancing. Because I was very, very known at that time, that kirtan time, I am away from kirtans. And then slowly, from that day onwards, even before I could realize, I saw that my legs are in the air and I have started little bit jumping and dancing. So, when we do kirtans, when we dance, when we clap, what happens is, all the sinful reactions which are there, just like in a jungle when a lion enters, what happens? All the animals flee out of fear. Am I right? So likewise, when the holy name of the Lord is uttered, all the sinful reactions which are overpowering us, over many, many lifetimes we have completed, those sinful reactions, the sinful tendencies starts fleeing away. They start running out of fear. Bhirapi yad bhibeti. Fear personified is fearful of Lord Shri Krishna. Bhirapi yad bhibeti. So all the sinful reactions gets, so to say, wiped out, and we become vidunoti surutsatam, we become purified. So now, part of the purification, we talked about, if we have to perceive the Lord who is divine, we should have divine vision. We cannot have divine vision unless we become divine. To become divine, we have to be pure internally and externally. To become pure internally, we have to follow the process which acharyas have given for our internal purification. For our internal purification and external purification also, we talked about the four do's. Can anyone remember? What are the four do's? A, B, C, D. Simple formula. Remember that. Keep doing this and purification will happen. Depending on how sincerely, how quickly and how effectively we do this, we'll have the purification happening. So A stands for association, satsang. Sometimes, inadvertently, unknowingly, we end up missing lot of sessions. Kisi din, one session, guest ghar mein aa gaye. Second session, I was out of station. Third session, you know, match chal raha tha. Last match tha, final match tha. So this, always remember, we can either go in a positive loop or a negative loop. Negative loop means if we are getting in the negative, no association, no reading, no chanting, it will attract more of that. The motivation to chant, motivation to read, motivation to come will reduce, will wane. And we can completely get, so to say, entangled. As grihasthas, no doubt we will have a lot of commitments. We respect that. We cannot say that every day you can come. No doubt there will be some exams for the children. But try your best. Try your best not to let big gaps come in. Slowly what will happen is, just like imagine if we don't take bath daily, what will happen? It will become unclean. Just like we don't charge our batteries, it will get completely drained. So A stands for association. As far as possible, on a regular basis we should have. For some reason if we miss the classes, no doubt even that class is not enough. On a daily basis we can have some association, reading, hearing, Shunvata, Swakatha, Krishna. Books, B for books. Prabhupada said, I have not written this books for selling and making money. It's for us to read and benefit from. He used to get up at 1 o'clock in the night till 5 o'clock. He would transcribe, took a lot of pains for us, not for selling and making money. So B for books, C for chanting, and D for diet. Eating pure sanctified food. Jaisa an, vaisa man. If we eat pure sanctified food, slowly it will usher in purification of consciousness. Don'ts. What are the don'ts? One thing which will clean us proactively and something which will make us unclean. On one side, like last time we said, we are filling water in a bucket. We want the bucket to be full. And there are some holes in the bucket which will drain out all the water. Net, we may find, you know, I've been filling for last so many days, but there is no water in the bucket because it's all drained out. So what are the don'ts? So predominantly four do's and four don'ts. What are the four don'ts? Television. No meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex. Looks simple, but to follow in spirit, it's not very easy. As Indians, some of the things are very obvious. Maybe we have come from very families where all these things are not indulged in. But in present times, there is a current, you know, even we see women have started smoking, drinking has become very common. Slowly those values are getting eroded. First time when I saw, don't take me wrong, first time when I saw a lady smoking in India, an Indian, that was I think 4 or 5 years back in Bangalore, it was difficult for me to believe. I had heard that yes, in colleges girls have started smoking, but it was difficult for me. I saw it and then it was difficult for me to comprehend. And now in Mumbai, we see it very, very often, very frequently. And there is no element of shyness that, you know, you're doing something wrong. Maybe you have some habit which you don't do publicly. You do it, what will people think, what will people say? You know, there's some element of guilt feeling. We see it very commonly. Prabhupada says, when the safety wall, the woman's main ornament is shyness. When the safety wall is broken, it will create havoc in the society. And we may say, no, this is all, you know, this all old thing you're talking about, Smanji. This is a modern world. Yes, it's a modern world, we understand. But what consequences? In America, so-called modern world, the biggest challenge they have is teenage pregnancies. 13-year-old girl, 14-year-old girl aborting their children. Or, you know, getting married at 14 years, begetting a child. What kind of society we're talking about? And having relationship, live in relationships, and then breaking that relationship, children having single parenting. It's all, you know, not healthy. So, four regulative principles, it pollutes our consciousness, degrades us, it disqualifies us, takes us away. We are meant for leading pure lives. for higher values, higher understanding. No doubt there is element of happiness in these things. This happiness is there even in animal form. Recently, Me Too, you know, there was a lot of things, people, so-called celebrities, big, eminent people in the society, but, you know, falling for what? Very base pleasures. So Buddha, you know, why did Buddha advent? Why did Lord Buddha advent? What was the main purpose? Anyone? In the name of Vedas, when people started rampantly killing animals in the name of sacrifice, he came and his main teaching was Ahimsa, Ahimsa, Paramo Dharma. Because when a person is dabbling in, you know, rampantly killing, he cannot understand higher values, higher things. I saw a video on YouTube. Somehow I landed up in that video. Sometimes, you know, watching something and, you know, you have some suggestions. So this video was about, it's difficult for me to even mention, it was how to cull a chicken to get that boneless. So this person, he says, now I'm going to show you. It was a demonstration and he took a chicken out of the thing. Most of the people who are eating chicken may not have actually seen how it is being cut or butchered. May not. That's why Bernard Shaw said, if slaughterhouses had walls made of glass, most of the people would be vegetarians. So this person took the chicken or whatever, that hen, and you know, caught hold from the neck, and with no any kind of double thought, had that chuck, done, that head is separated, and then holding its leg, first time I am seeing this, I could not see the video full, holding the four legs, it just, you know, holding it down, it is not being captured in the camera. That whole thing is shaking, because, you know, suddenly it doesn't become lifeless, it is shaking, and, you know, it's allowing it to bleed and calm down, relax, and then, you know, I stopped that video. I knew that now he's going to bring it up and do the balance thing, just for our taste buds. It will have repercussions. So Buddha, when in the name of Vedas animal killing became very prominent, Buddha came and said Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. That was his prime purpose of adventing. No doubt he gave so many other teachings also, but that was the essence, Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. Because he realized there is no point in talking about higher subject matter where we are disqualified at the very fundamental level. Fundamentals are not in place. There's no, if suppose somebody doesn't know 1 plus 1, 2 plus 3, basic addition, subtraction, what is talk about algebra, trigonometry and higher advanced mathematics? First you have to get your fundamentals right. So that was the reason I came. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see the God. This is Matthew in the Bible. So human life is meant for purification. Labdhva sudurlabham bahu sambhavante, after many births we go. And this human life is shudhyed, meant for purification. Tapo divyam shudhyed brahma saukhyam tanantam. And how do we become tapo divyam? By divine tapasya, we'll become purified. We all want happiness. We all are striving for that. Acharyas are showing us the way. Nothing wrong about wanting happiness. But there is a way of achieving that happiness. The real happiness, that lasting happiness. That happiness which we actually are striving to achieve. What does it mean to be in the world but not of the world? Again, Jesus made this statement. Be in the world but not of the world. What does it mean? In this world, this is samsara sagara. It's Maya's kingdom. Lot of allurements are there. Lot of current is there for us to pull down, for us to become impure. be in this world but not of the world. The example is given of a lotus is in the pond but not of the pond, in the sense it is untouched by the impurities of the pond. So when we, just like inoculation, when we take some vaccination, the infection may be there, but we are protected. So when we inoculate with chanting the names of the Lord, hearing Shrunvata, Swakatha, Krishna, Punya Shavana Kirtana, all these abhadras, all the dirty things, all the impurities will untouch, will not be touching us. No doubt it doesn't happen immediately. It will take time because we are conditioned, we are habituated to go for all those things. There's a natural inclination. There's a taste for those things. World over, religion has been misunderstood and misused by people with selfish motives. For example, politicians, leaders, kings, rulers, even the so-called near Shabrimala. You know, these all are, you know, these all have some vested interests without understanding the context, why some rules are made, what is the rationale. World over, religion has been misunderstood for misuse of people with selfish motive, politicians, leaders, kings, rulers, without proper training, without having background understanding. What is religion meant for? What is the original purpose? In the war, World War II, when the Nazis, you know, they were believers in God. So they had the belts around their waist which says that praise thy Lord and praise the Lord and press the gun. You know, and wars have been fought in the name of religion, in the name of God. One time I was traveling by air, a person sitting next to me, next seat, you know, he was a retired army colonel. So we started talking and then he looked at me, looked at my dress, he says, you're a monk? I said, yes. So then he said, 40 years I have served in the army. And most of the wars which we have fought or which are being fought the world over is in the name of religion and God. Hence, I don't believe in God. That was his, after having gone through all that, you know, having fought some wars, being part of this thing, he says, I don't believe in God now. Yes, it's a fact that people have misunderstood because it has been misused by people with ulterior motives, selfish motives. But otherwise, the purpose of religion, dharma vihina, anyone would like to complete? Pashubi samana. If you remove dharma, dharmic principles, the regulations from our life, then we are like animals. Maybe doing the same thing in a more polished way. Now, what is Prabhupada translated? What is religion? He gave a very nice definition of religion. Religion is a process of elevating ourselves through various platforms of understanding to the highest degree of human life. So we have various platforms of understanding. What is life? What is the purpose of life? Who I am? It's elevating. Slowly, as you purify, you elevate in your consciousness. You have a higher and higher understanding of what is life. What is the purpose of life? The religion is a process of elevating ourselves through various platforms of understanding to the highest degree of human life. Now, here, your mind has been perturbed upon seeing this horrible feature of mine. This is a word spoken by? Word spoken by? By? Krishna. Now let it be finished. My devotee, be free from all disturbance. With a peaceful mind, you can now see the form you desire. So the horrible feature of mine, the universal form with all those, you know, Bhishma, Drona and all those forms getting, you know, entering into the mount, getting devastated. That was basically to tell Arjuna that anyway, we're not going to fight, it's inevitable. They're anyway going to die. Nimitta matra bhav satsaju. Just be an instrument and take the credit. A devotee is not very much interested in the universal form. I also want to see Vishwarupa. He is satisfied serving the Lord in its transcendental spiritual form and experience loving reciprocation. Now, we talked about it in one of our earlier sessions. This is a test for all of you. If we have to plant a tree, a sapling, and get fruits, what are the important elements which we have to take care of? What are the important elements for that plant to grow, become a tree, and have fruits? Anyone will help me with an answer? Right? Seed. Okay. So I'll go one by one. First, the farmer should be right. He should have knowledge when to plant. Am I right? Which season to plant? How to plant? Just intent of growing a plant is not enough. I got some plants for my room when I was staying in Bangalore, indoor plants. And, you know, I was really geared up. I will take care, good care of the plants. And every day I used to water. And then slowly, I said, kya ho gaya inko? Every day I'm watering. So sometimes plants wilt because you forget to water. Am I right? Here I'm watering every day. And finally, you know, they wilted. And I went to the gardener and said, daily pani mat dalo. He was angry at me. Kyun dal rahe ho pani daily? So, the farmer should have the right knowledge. When to plant? What is the right season, right time, right conditions? So, what is farmer equivalent to? What is a farmer equivalent to? Good farmer. A genuine guru. A bona fide spiritual master. Okay. A farmer has planted, what are the other conditions required for the plant to grow? Huh? Fertile soil. No, you can't put a plant, a good farmer puts the seed here. Next week we'll come, you know, we'll have a good sapling coming out of the stage. Yes, no? So, the soil should be fertile. What does that mean? A sincere and a good disciple. Prabhupada says, who is a good disciple who is ready to be disciplined by the Guru? Disciple word comes from discipline. The do's and don'ts, he will meticulously follow the do's and don'ts. Disciple is not an ornamental thing. Yes, I am a disciple. He is my Guru. You follow the instructions. So fertile soil is equivalent to a good disciple who follows the rules and regulations, who follows the prescription. And one more ingredient. A good farmer, fertile soil and a potent seed. You may have a good farmer, you may have a fertile soil, but the seed is bad. So if these three things are there, you have a good farmer who has the knowledge of farming, you have a fertile soil, and you have a potent seed, which is message in its pure form, coming in disciplic succession. If we have these three ingredients, a genuine guru, which is a must. If we are a good disciple, we are ready to be disciplined by a genuine guru, willing to follow his instructions, prescriptions, and we have pure message. These days we have many gurus, sincere disciples, but a wrong message. Sambhog sa sambhadi. You know, somebody has come up with his philosophy. So genuine guru, good disciple, pure message, and if all these ingredients are there, and then we have the plant growing, blossoming, flowering, and finally having the fruits. And the ultimate fruit is, what is the ultimate fruit? Is love of God. Right now, we have got separated from the Lord, forgotten the Lord. Although the relationship is there, that's got somehow forgotten or severed. We revive that relationship, that loving relationship. We develop that love. Prabhupada says, you cannot remember God or you cannot remember a person unless you love him. A lover and a beloved, it is not difficult for them to not remember each other. In fact, it is difficult for them to forget each other before marriage, not after marriage, before marriage. So, while they are working, thinking of that. So, when you love a person, the thinking becomes natural. So, when we develop love of God, thinking of God, remembering God, obeying God, following His instruction becomes a default mode of function. And that is the ultimate objective. Any questions? Anything you'd like to ask? And then we move on. Prabhuji? Shisha Prabhu ko bola. Any questions? Yes. Divine form? He has the divine vision. Why he has a divine vision? Because he is a devotee of the Lord. Bhakto sime sakha cheti rahasyad hi etat uttamam. I am speaking this knowledge to you because bhakto sime sakha cheti, you are my bhakta, you are my devotee, you are non-envious of me. Deep within, envy doesn't mean that we decry the Lord openly. Envy means we want to be the center. We want to be the enjoyer. What is Lord? Lord means He is the enjoyer. He is the controller. He is the master. He is the proprietor. He is the well-wisher of everyone. When we want to take the position of the Lord, may not be, you know, very explicitly, implicitly in our actions. Action speaks louder than words. We want to be the center of attraction. We want to look good. We want people to praise me. We want to control things. There is no dependence on the Lord. I will control things. I will manage this thing. That tendency. Lust. What is lust? Desire to enjoy. Completely out of, Lord is out of picture. So Arjuna does not have that. Bhakto sime sakha cheti rahasya dhi eta uttamam. Now I am going to share this rahasya because you are a bhakta. Krishna also says in the Gita, Naham prakasha sarvasya yogo maya samanvrita. I do not reveal myself to everyone. And I am concealed by my yoga maya potency. So when we become devotees of the Lord reveals himself.